This talk introduces DeepClone, a scalable live migration of deep learning models for data parallel training approaches. I'm Bogdan Nicolae, a computer scientist at Argonne National Laboratory, and this is a joint collaboration with Justin Bosnia Matedoria and Frank Capello, also from Argonne National Laboratory. So let me begin by emphasizing the importance of AI in the HPC community. It's becoming a driving force, and some sources claim it will be 40% of the HPC market by 2025. And this is not surprising because more and more scientific applications use AI directly as a tool to obtain the result. And in any case, it is very valuable as a tool to augment traditional HPC applications, which come in the form of simulations that run at large scale on supercomputers and so are very tedious and time consuming and resource intensive, and AI can help accelerate them significantly. Examples in this space would be reducing the number of simulations that you need to run, or within each simulation using a deep learning model to skip time-consuming iterations by estimating the result through inferences. Deep learning is particularly popular with HPC applications because of its ability to learn complex problems. Of course, with this comes also complexity of deep learning itself. In particular, the workflows are not just training and inference, they include many other steps, such as finding the ideal network architecture and hyperparameters, and doing some post-processing, like sensitivity analysis, where we want to identify tolerance to outliers and potential for generalization of the network, whether it can, for example, solve a similar problem without retraining, or what features are important in the various decisions that the network has taken, and so on, right? So what these complex workflows have in common is the need to explore a large number of alternative training paths and DNN architectures and hyperparameters, right? And the notion of alternative introduces the need to capture the model state and either revisit it later or to replicate it and continue the training process in an alternative parallel direction. And in this paper, we focus in this second case, which we refer to as cloning. So let me give you an example here. In the exascale computing project, there is an application that looks at three major challenges in cancer research. It's called CANDLE, Cancer Deep Learning Environment. And it's one of the few examples of applications that mostly rely on AI to obtain the results in the HPC space specifically. So sensitivity analysis is particularly important here because we want to explain the results and investigate the data quality and learning patterns. And instead of doing a naive inclusion and exclusion of learning samples to compare the training outcomes, we can do more elaborate approaches that adopt a recursive telescopic inclusion and exclusion of the learning samples. And such workflows involve branching off in different directions at each recursion step, right? And this means that the cloning becomes an important primitive that is called very frequently, and so it needs to be very efficient. So not only do we have to explore a large number of training directions in parallel, but each direction in itself is more complicated than a single training process running on a single node. So increasingly we see approaches such as data parallelism and model parallelism gaining traction, especially at large scale. And in the case of data parallelism, this involves model replicas that look at different training samples and then average the gradients and synchronize the weights. Or in the case of model parallelism, layers getting split across multiple workers. And so you have parallelism at the level of each layer. In addition, modern deep learning frameworks like the TensorFlow adopt layer-wise parallelism. And this basically creates a pipeline that can be embedded directly in the execution graph. So let's take an example. Here in this figure, we have four layers. And during backpropagation, we start with the rightmost layer and we compute the local gradients. But immediately after we have computed the local gradients, we can already start computing the local gradients of the previous layer while in parallel updating the weights of the last layer. And so this then continues on and on in a backward fashion until we reach the first layer. Now, this approach can be combined with data and model parallel approaches, the combination with data parallel approaches being very popular. And as you can see here, the interesting part is that the averaging of the gradients can be done on a per layer basis and then can become part of this layer-wise parallel pipeline, and therefore the collective operations, typically all reduce, needed to perform the averaging can overlap and be done in parallel. So now we can finally formulate the cloning problem. And in particular, we focus on the combination of data parallel and layer-wise parallel training approaches because they are the most popular in practice. And so given a set of model replicas that correspond to the initial training direction, which we call the sources, the question becomes how can we replicate them into another set of model replicas that we call the clones and that correspond to the alternative training direction that we want to explore. In doing so, we want to minimize not only the runtime overhead of the original training instance, but also how long in advance we need to start the clones before the training step during which we initiate the cloning has finished, which we call the standby duration, and how long the clones take from the end of the training step until they are ready to continue, which we call the readiness duration. Now, it is important to observe that we really care about these two last overheads and not only about the runtime overhead of the original training instance, because if we start the clones too soon, then we have to pay for extra core hours, and the earlier the clones can continue training after the training step has finished, the earlier they will finish their work, and so the earlier the alternative direction will be explored. So now it would seem that checkpointing would be an obvious solution to the cloning problem as we formulated it earlier, and advantages would be the fact that we already have production-ready approaches from dedicated checkpointing libraries like Veloci, which is part of the Exascale Computing project, to workflow runtimes like Adios and Data Spaces or key value stores that can keep checkpoints in memory if we have enough of it, and this can save a lot of IO overheads, right? And so these were developed over long periods of time and include a lot of optimizations like leveraging heterogeneous storage stacks or masking IO overheads through asynchronous operations and so on, right? But I would argue that it is not enough for two major reasons. First of all, they don't have awareness of data parallelism, and what this means is that they miss the opportunity of leveraging multiple sources for getting the same data, right? So there are alternatives that they don't know about. And then secondly, they are typically optimized for checkpointing and then restart or reconstructing the model state in this case as separate operations, right? But when we do cloning, we need to capture and reconstruct the model state at the same time, right? So there are maybe overlappings possible that we can exploit and that can lead to further optimizations. more closer to what we want to do is live migration, which is mostly applied at system level for containers and virtual machines. But such approaches wouldn't be feasible because if we use a container or a VM for our data, first of all, it would have a large overhead, and then secondly, we wouldn't benefit from awareness of data parallelism either. So to address the limitations of state of art, we propose DeepClone, which is an efficient cloning proposal for the combination of data parallel and layer-wise parallel training approaches. And the key idea that we apply in this context is the fact that we don't have to wait for the training step to finish before we can send the model state to the set of cloned replicas, right? Instead, we can already do that during the backpropagation. And how do we do that? Well, we basically split each tensor, so at very fine granularity, into a number of shards, the number corresponding to the number of replicas. And so in doing that, then we can have each replica of the sources send a different shard to its corresponding cloned replica. Now, what this means is that the sources will spend much less time in sending data to the clones at the expense that the clones have to reconstruct the full tensors by using collective operations such as altgather. So to further reduce the overhead of sending the shards to the clones, we also augment the execution graph with such a send operation. So during the backpropagation, sends will happen immediately after the tensor updates, and they can happen in parallel with the computation of the local gradients, right? So a lot of the overhead of sending then can be overlapped with the backpropagation. And then third, we can afford to do zero copy transfers using non-blocking operations, because once the tensors have been updated, they remain immutable up until the backpropagation of the next iteration, and so we have an entire forward pass that we can leverage in during which the tensors remain immutable, right? So that's why this technique is very efficient. Now, looking at the reconstruction, there are certain issues there that relate to how tensor shards may arrive in different order, and that means we cannot overlap the altgather operations with the receiving of the tensors because of this ordering issues, and we can apply other optimizations instead, such as you know, calling all gather operations in the same order as the tensors are needed during the forward pass, and more details about this are available in the paper. We implemented DeepClone on top of TensorFlow and Horovod. And in particular, in the case of TensorFlow, we used the custom C++ kernel implementations to actually access the tensors and provide the zero copy functionality that is central to our approach. We used as a lower level libraries an optimized version of Intel MKL and Python, and this was part of the software ecosystem running on the Tita pre-exascale machine where we ran our experiments. And you can take a moment to pause in order to see all the details. So we compared the DeepClone in a series of experiments with two other approaches. One of them implements checkpointing, and it involves one of the source replicas saving the model state as a file to a parallel file system using the HDF5 format. And this happens in a blocking fashion after the training step has finished. And the group can then continue training in the initial direction. But after the checkpoint has been written to the parallel file system, the cloned replicas are started and they begin reading in parallel the model state from the HDF5 file, and then continue the training in the alternative direction. The second approach is based on MPI, and it involves peer-to-peer transfer. So specifically, each source replica sends the model directly to the corresponding replica from the clone group, again using blocking I/O after each training step. The metrics we use for comparison are the ones that we defined in the problem formulation, runtime overhead, standby duration, and readiness duration. And we use two applications. One is a benchmark from ECP Candle, it's called NT3, and the other one is the ResNet 50 family of benchmarks that are very popular in the deep learning community. And we have three variations of NT3 and three variations of ResNet that are listed in the table included on the slide. Next, I would like to highlight a few results that we obtained. And first, I would like to focus on the scalability for an increasing group size. What we can observe is that in terms of runtime overhead, our approach is up to 25 times faster compared with the other two approaches. So this is thanks to the fact that most of the transfers from the sources to the clones are overlapped with the backpropagation, which is not the case for the other two approaches that wait until the training step has finished to initiate such transfers. And in terms of readiness duration, the trend is similar, and we see a reduction of overhead of up to 35 times, again because the reconstruction of the model state on the clones is overlapped with the backpropagation as well. As a trade-off, in some cases we see that our approach requires a longer standby duration, and this is normal because we need to start the clones earlier during the backpropagation. But in practice, this is not a problem because usually the other two metrics are more important and need to be optimized compared to the standby duration. Another aspect that is important to discuss here is also the better scalability for our proposal. So with an increasing group size, the runtime overhead and the readiness duration are decreasing, whereas it stays the same or even slightly increases for the other two approaches, which means we have an increasing gap, and at a large scale this makes a big difference. We also focused on the scalability of our proposal versus the other two approaches when the group size is fixed to 8 nodes, which is the maximum used in our experiments, but the model configuration is variable. And so the interesting takeaway here is that an increasing model size and number of layers leads to an increasing gap between our proposal and the other two approaches. So this complements very well the scalability results that we obtained earlier for an increasing group size. So to conclude, what are the key takeaways from this talk? Well, in deep learning workflows we need to explore a lot of alternative directions in parallel, and so we need to rely on cloning as a primitive to achieve this with minimal overhead. This is a much better solution than checkpointing because it optimizes the problem of capturing and replicating the model state in a distributed fashion. And when paired together with advanced training approaches that involve data parallelism and layer-wise parallelism. It can facilitate approaches such as DeepClone that achieves much better results compared with state-of-art approaches. So I would also like to acknowledge the funding sources that made this research possible, and with this to thank you for your attention.